This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: Biography of Ramakrishna Paramhansa by Pradeep Pandit. Preface: Why read Ramakrishna Paramhansa? At first glance, a book on the saint from Dakhineshwar in Paschim Banga may trigger this question. Multiple explanations can be dished out in answer to the question, one being that Ramakrishna's teachings help in the resuscitation of religious values in a rather frothy, ephemeral age. It would, however, be erroneous to limit Ramakrishna's contribution to the realms of spirituality alone. More than religious values, what stands out prominently is his emphasis on basic human values at a time when existential angst has burrowed into the human heart like never before. It's here that Ramakrishna's teachings find their core appeal that cuts across a wide cross-section of audience, including the youth. For all the craving, carping, conniving and shenanigans of the world that have left humankind exhausted of its reserves, the question that Ramakrishna's teachings pose is this: all this but for what? The transience of life is but the harshest reality, which we have deliberately brushed under the carpet. Perhaps, we are afraid to look reality in the eye and dread facing the fear of uncertainty that envelops the morrow. Worldly contraptions offer momentary respite from the stings of truth. The day we understand the futility of our exercise in our quest for one-upmanship is the day we attain self-realization. That's the day we begin to channelize our energy in seeking the absolute truth, which in the collective consciousness is called God. What's best about Ramakrishna's sermons is that they are not sermons at all. At least, they do not appear to be by the way they are expounded. The instances he gives, the anecdotes with which he spices up his spiritual messages are so intimately real that you identify with them. To think that he was born in 1836 in a decrepit village in Bengal, had inconsequential academic grounding and spoke in rustic Bangla, makes it difficult for one to believe that Ramakrishna represents the very core of the spiritual realization of the seers and sages of India. Ramakrishna knew that his messages must reach the higher echelons of the Bhadralok community, just as they must percolate down to the unlettered masses. A quietistic saint who founded a universalist and socially active religious movement, a metamorphosis linked to the reformist and proselytizing zeal of his chief disciple, Swami Vivekananda, Ramakrishna displayed a strong streak of pragmatism when it came to explaining his ideas. Precisely the reason why his memory has not been obfuscated by the passage of time even after about 150 years of his death. The simplicity with which he recounted easy-to-relate tales struck an instant chord with his audience. The greatest contribution of Ramakrishna to the modern world is his message of religious harmony. To him, all religions were the revelation of God in his diverse aspects, to satisfy the manifold demands of the human mind. He always insisted that, like different photographs of a building taken from different angles, different religions give us the picture of one truth from different points of view. The diverse views are not contradictory but complementary. Today, with Machiavellians at work to cash in on religious intolerance, Ramakrishna's Many Religions, One God Gospel offers a perspective which we need to heed, now more than ever. The man who initiated no cult arrived at a time when the very foundation of religion and faith in God was crumbling under the relentless blows of materialism and skepticism. Ramakrishna, through his burning spiritual realization, demonstrated how God resides in each one of us. His amiable approach was shorn of verbosity and religious hocus-pocus, which he knew could elude the lexicon of a layman. Implicit faith, bhakti, he said, is what helps one squeeze through the eye of the needle and attain God consciousness. Ramakrishna led by example. He lived a simple life with not a shade of conceit in him, though his eccentric mannerisms were occasionally misconstrued. Ramakrishna attached paramount importance to the youth being initiated on the path of spirituality. "I am merely the initiator," he used to say, it's the youth who will lead the way to the ultimate truth. He was proud he had a battery of young Turks like Swami Vivekananda as his disciples. When a young disciple once asked him if it is proper to get married while trying to know God, Ramakrishna said, one should try not to. But it's better to get married than ruin not tasting the marital soup for the entire life. This could dent his concentration. This book is an earnest endeavor to bring to the readers a man who lived his own teachings and, like a silent force, influences our spiritual thought currents even to this day. Gliding through the pages that bring alive his life and times, one can find solace in his utterances, a serene comfort which is so rare today in the midst of the ripples created by the daily rigmarole of life. Udayan Mukherjee. 1. The Beginning. The closer you come to God, the less you reason. Or are you? The moment you are united with Him. Everything else ceases, arguments and rationalizing. One then goes into a samadhi, deep meditation. Attaining complete silent communion with God. Ramakrishna Paramahamsa. Great men like Guru Nanak, Lord Buddha or Lord Krishna are not born as humans every day. Rarely do stars herald the birth of a divine soul who would affect the Bengal Renaissance during the 19th and 20th centuries. Apart from his stature as avatar or God's personification, Ramakrishna Paramahamsa's enduring influence emanates from his pragmatism, his simplicity of thoughts which are not religious encumbrances but are real and practical. On February 18, 1836, Ramakrishna or Gadadhar was born in a quiet village of Kamapukur in Hooghly, a small district in Bengal. His parents were poor but pious. His father was Khudiram Chattopadhyay and mother Chandra Devi. They had moved to Kamapukur in 1814 and settled there permanently. Kamapukur was a very quiet and tranquil village, surrounded by fields, tall palm trees and greenery. It had a rustic charm quite untouched by the glamour of the city. The permeating peace had a profound influence on Ramakrishna. Pilgrims to Jagannath Puri passed through Kamapukur. Reminiscing about his parents, Ramakrishna once said, "My mother was an apotheosis of civility and piety. She was not worldly and forthright. This quality endeared her to the people of the village. My father was an orthodox Brahmin and did not accept gifts from Shudras. He would spend most of his time praying to the Lord and singing devotional songs. So deep was his devotion that tears flowed unchecked when he offered his prayers. In his spare time he made garlands for Lord Raghuveer, his family deity." Ramakrishna's forefathers were from Daraipur village, quite close to Kamapukur. His grandfather, Manikram Chattopadhyay, belonged to a staunch orthodox Brahmin family. However, the family was extremely generous. Manikram was wealthy according to the existing standards of the time, with 50 acres of land. His practical and humble nature distinguished him. The Chattopadhyay family was popular in the village because of his generous character. Ramakrishna's father, Khudiram, was born in 1775 and had two brothers and a sister. On completion of his formal education from the village school, he got married to Chandra Devi at the age of 24. Khudiram had to look after the house when his father died. He had acquired his father's good qualities and dispensed his responsibilities graciously, which made him as popular as his father. They say that money alone doesn't ensure the route to happiness. More than material resources, what brings perfect felicity in a family is trust and dependence on each other. To that end, Chandra Devi, or Chandra as she was fondly called, was a perfect wife, going about her duties with precision and having unflappable faith in the decisions of her husband. She too was as compassionate as Khudiram and soon came to be known as Ma in hours of crisis. 9 years after marriage, Chandra Devi was blessed with her first child, a son she named Ramkumar. Life is full of vagaries, and a time came when misfortune drove a wedge between Khudiram's happiness. The village zamindar Ramanand was a wild man given to corrupt practices, as were most zamindars of the time. Ramanand wanted Khudiram to stand witness to a case, as he knew that the latter's reputation would help him win a case in his favour. He knew Khudiram would not agree to be a party to a false case and had to be cajoled to do it. As expected, Khudiram disapproved of being a party to a falsehood which could affect someone's destiny. He was a God-fearing person and despite repeated messages from the zamindar, kept fobbing off the matter. After a lot of dilly-dallying, Khudiram finally garnered the courage to say no. That the sledgehammer would fall on Khudiram was anybody's guess. The zamindar was livid and to teach Khudiram a lesson etched out false documents by dint of which he usurped Khudiram's landed property. He did not even spare his ancestral home. This left Khudiram on the streets, literally. His faith in Lord Raghuveer was, however, never faltered. In fact, it grew stronger with the crisis. His brothers took refuge with their in-laws, but Khudiram had nowhere to go. It was then that a friend, Sukram Goswami, suggested that he leave Baruipur and shift base to Kamapukur to begin life afresh. Sukram, who was a zamindar, wasn't like the rest of the ilk. He was compassionate and his love for his village was well known. He invited Khudiram and accommodated him in one portion of his palatial house. Misfortune, however, struck again and Sukram passed away in 1824. His passing away saw his ancestral house being reduced to ruins until it was sold off to Laha family. At the age of 39, Khudiram, along with his wife and two kids, laid the foundation stone of his new house in Kamapukur. Adversity had failed to make him cringe and his faith in the Almighty paid off. The society was gradually metamorphosing, for the worse unfortunately. Doublespeak and cynicism were slowly spreading their tentacles. All this did not hamper Khudiram's progress. Not merely a house, he also managed to get half an acre of land for himself, that too one that was eminently fertile. Then came a turning point in Khudiram's life. While returning from a sojourn to a nearby village, he fell asleep under a tree. Lord Raghuveer arrived in his dream and said, "I am tired of being here. Take me to your house." "But my lord, despite being a devotee, I am too poor to even think of taking you to my house," Khudiram pleaded. At this stage he was jolted out of his slumber. Realizing he had been ordained by the Lord, he dug up the ground at a little distance from the tree as instructed and found an idol of Raghuveer. A serpent guarding the idol slowly moved away, as if satisfied that the idol had fallen into the safe hands of an able caretaker. The deity's presence made Khudiram a household name. His love and devotion for the Lord was much talked about. He soon became the cynosure of the villagers, who showered their respect on him and his family.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.